Thank you for the introduction. So let me join all the people thanking the organizers for this very nice event and being able to put it up despite the circumstances, and also giving me the opportunity of presenting my work. So what I want to talk to you about today is, let's say, it's a class of models that have been introduced recently, so in the last 2 or 3 years. They can be thought as the generalization to the quantum realm of well-known classical extrusion processes, so, which have been talked about already this morning by Sylvain and Kiron. Before anything, let me present the people that are involved on this project. So this set of works have mainly been done during my PhD with under the supervision of Denis Bernard. And we were also working in tight collaboration with Michel Bauer, who I'm sure many of you here know well. And other people involved are Roach Spielberg, Alexandre Kragenbrink, and Marco, who is here in the background. The outline of the talk will be quite simple, so I won't go into any details of how you perform calculation on these models or how you get the analytical result, but I will rather focus on the general ideas. And so first I will present the model, and then I will just throw all the results at you, and if you have any questions about them, I will be happy to discuss, of course. So first let me talk about the model. So I want to start with the classical extrusion process. So it has already been discussed, so maybe we can skip this slide, but just for completeness, let's go through it. So you have a classical particle, okay, that hops in a stochastic way on a discrete lattice. And you have a minimal set of rules for this problem, which are that they can't overlap. Okay, that's why it's called extrusion. And also you have some probability rates per unit time of them jumping to the right or to the left. So usually these models are considered in continuous time. And you can also put them out of equilibrium by injecting and extracting boundaries. So alpha is the rate of injecting particles at the left boundary, and beta is the rate of extraction, and similarly for the right and boundary. And depending on the value of P and Q, you have different classes of models. So if P is equal to Q, then you have the symmetric simple extrusion process. If P is different from Q, it's the asymmetric one. Then you have HOSO, so you have the TASEP, which is the one where they only hop in one direction. So these models have met a lot of success because they are a very simple formulation, but they have rich structure, and they were also very helpful in understanding basic ideas in out-of-equilibrium statistical physics. So as was mentioned by Kiron, for instance, the large deviation principles and macroscopic fluctuation theory were, I think, first deciphered on such settings. So what we want to do is to have a quantum version of this thing, because we can help that it will also helps like for the formulation of like the quantum equivalent of large deviation theory, macroscopic fluctuation, and so on. So how do you do that? So one systematic way of embedding a classical problem in the quantum one is by making this identification, okay? So by definition, you can always associate to classical configuration a set of element of basis for your quantum Hilbert space, okay? Just because they are the results of measurements, and the results of measurements can be taken as a classical configuration for a problem. Okay. So here, the natural basis or classical configuration that you choose are the occupation number. Okay. So we are, for the quantum problem, we are going always to work in the occupation number basis. And if you restrict to only those states, then you have the classical extrusion process. Okay. So somehow the quantum extrusion process will be something more general in which the classical extrusion process is embedded. But of course, there is a richer structure in the quantum realm because you can have superposition and entanglement. Okay. So for instance, here it's a classical configuration. You have a particle at this life. Here is another classical configuration. And for the quantum problem, you can consider this type of state. So you take that as a ket. Okay. It's a superposition of this particle being here or here. Okay. And of course, this does not have a classical equivalent. So this is the kind of object we will be particularly interested about. Okay. So how do you do that concretely? So here is the model. So let me explain it in detail. So this DHT is what will generate the dynamics. Okay, meaning that if I for an infinitesimal time step dt. Okay, meaning that if I take the exponential of this thing, I can make a state evolve from time t to t plus dt. Okay. Here, C and C dagger, they are the fermionic annihilation and creation operator. So it's the usual one on a discrete lattice. So you see that this thing, it describes the jump from j plus 1 to j, and this one the other way around. And the important objects, okay, are those dw and dw bar. So those are quantum noises. So I don't know if many of you are familiar with the concept of quantum noises, but okay, it's hard to explain in 5 minutes. But let's say that a good way to wrap your mind around this object is to think of them as the generalization of classical stochastic processes continuous in time, such, for instance, the Brownian motion, classical physics, to the quantum realm. So in general, those things they can be not number, okay? It's not an obligation. But for simplification, during the rest of the talk, we'll be mainly focused on a particular case where you can think of them as a complex number. So just W, think of it as a Brownian motion in a complex plane, okay? And W bar is its conjugate. Okay, so they are random variable. It's a stochastic process. And it means that your jump here, they are weighted by random numbers, okay? So those are what I call the quantum noise. And something important also is that there is an index J, okay, for the edge. We will take all the quantum noises statistically independent at each edge, okay?
Where is the exponent here? It's just three particles.
Yeah, I'll explain where it comes from. So there are a number of remarks I want to make. So first of all, where is the exclusion? So the exclusion principle comes from the fact that we are dealing with fermions. Okay, so it is very naturally coming out since by Pauli exclusion principle, you can't have two fermions on the same side. So here you have the same thing. Okay. Why is it named the quantum exclusion process? It's because of this embedding that I talked about earlier, so I will not show it explicitly, but if you write the quantum master equation associated to this evolution, okay, so by writing the density matrix and expanding these guys, if you write this down, then, and you restrict yourself to the occupation number basis, okay, and you see the weight, of the Liouvillean between two different states, they are exactly the same as the weights given by the classical Markovian transition matrix. Okay? It means that, to say it more shortly, it means that if I just restrict to this occupation number basis, I don't see any difference with exclusion processes, classical exclusion processes. Okay? The quantum master equation is the same as the classical Markov transition matrix. But of course, as I said before, there is more in the quantum problem because you have these coherences. So that was the second point I wanted to make. The third one is that, so it's a bit more technical, it's about the quantum noises. It's like those objects, okay, the stochastic processes, the Markovian stochastic processes are continuous in time. They can be defined if they are Gaussian. They can be like the Brownian motion. They can be defined entirely by their Itô rules, and the Itô rules is just telling you what is the second momenta of this increment here. So depending on the statistical rule you choose for the second momenta, you have the mapping towards different classes of classical exclusion processes. Okay. So for instance, as I said, what we will consider mainly in the remainder of the talk is this situation where dw dw bar commutes. Okay. So in this case, as I told you, you can just interpret this as a complex number. And in that case, if this is fulfilled, then you have the quantum symmetric simple exclusion process. If it's not true, then you have the QSEP, but I will not talk much about this in the following.
Sorry. Yes. Just to make sure that I understand.
Yeah.
Do I understand correctly that what you mean in the second line is that if you start with a diagonal, the estimated then it remains a diagonal in the equation basis?
Yeah, if you restrict yourself to the occupation number basis, yeah, you don't. It's stable by the action of this thing.
Now there's one choice to transform into the Poisson noise or discrete noise or something.
Sorry.
Can you define the solution with a Brownian noise?
Yeah, it's a quantum noise, so it's a bit different. Yeah, but okay, you can think of it as a complex Brownian noise. Yeah, and
which is more continuous. While in the set, you have a discrete jumps between occupations. So I was wondering how you go from discontinuous noise to it.
So in the set. When you talk about the noise, you talk about what precisely, which quantity are you thinking about?
How you jump from the configuration to another in the Markov.
Okay, it's a bit different because here these objects, they don't tell you about the transition rates. Okay, they are going to generate them. Okay, but it's not directly. Equal, their statistics does not give you directly the statistic of the transition rate. Okay. So there is one step, so that's why it can be different. Okay, so another remark is that because it can be puzzling when you see it first, is that in this model there are two sources of randomness. The first one comes from the quantum uncertainty, and this is the deep one because you're studying a quantum problem, so you have the uncertainty of the measure. To take the average with respect to this uncertainty, you take the trace. But here, this thing is still a stochastic variable with respect to this probability space. Okay. And the second source of randomness comes from the fact that you're studying a stochastic process. Okay, so you have a source of randomness that comes from the noise W and W bar, and I will denote average with respect to this noise with this matcal E. So when you do that, you still have an observable. Okay, you're still dealing with an object, another morphism of your Hilbert space. And the last remark is that this thing is the dynamic is quadratic in fermionic operators, which is nice because it means that you can simplify considerably your problem by restricting to Gaussian states. Or another way to say it is that knowing the two-point function defined this way gives you every possible observable just by Vick's theorem. Okay, so this is nice. So this is what we will be focused on for all the application. Is this two-point correlation function. So this is a stochastic object, this is a random variable, and the question we will ask is what is the distribution of this thing? Okay, to somehow familiarize yourself with the model, I just want to show a very simple example. Of two sites for the symmetric quantum exclusion process. So you start from this situation. Okay, we will compare the classical and the quantum situation. So you start from this situation where you have a particular on site one, okay, and you let the system evolve Okay, it doesn't matter if it's periodic or not. And then you wonder what is going to be the stationary state of this thing. By stationary state, it means, it's always moving, but I mean the stationary measure. For SEP, there is a probability one half of being there, a probability one half of being there, end of the story. This gives you the mean density. For the quantum SEP, you can just write the dynamical equation on G's, this GIG I introduced before, so it's the 2-point correlation function. So if I evaluate them at the same site, it's going to give me the mean density, at site 1 or 2. And if you do that, you do the computation, you find one half and one half, So this is, what I told you earlier is that if you restrict to these occupation numbers, you get the same results than for SEP. So this is a manifestation of it, but you can ask more questions. So you can ask what is the stationary state G12. So G12, it encodes for, it's non-zero if you have a quantum superposition between site 1 and 2. So it encodes for coherences between your two sites, and you find that this thing is zero in average. So this is typically what you get from decoherence, right? Because decoherence is what? Is you put your quantum system in contact with an environment. If your model is nice enough, you have an effective description in terms of noise. And then if you wait long enough, you're going to go into a decohered state. But the interesting thing is that if you can also ask about the fluctuation of this guy. So it's zero in average, but what about second momenta? So this guy, and it's not zero, it's 1/6. Doesn't matter, the value, it's not important. Important thing is that it's different from zero, so it means that even in the stationary state, you still have fluctuating quantum coherences. Even more than that, they are built up dynamically, meaning that I started from this state, where this thing is only on the site 1, so there is no superposition between 1 and 2, no quantum coherences, and then I wait, I make a system evolve with this stochastic dynamics, and in the stationary state, I have fluctuation of these coherences. And this is a question you can ask for the classical problem, just because this quantity doesn't even exist. So that was the first part of the talk, was about introducing the concept and the model. Now I will just show you the results that we were able to obtain on different settings. So the first one is that when we try to derive the stationary measure for the quantum symmetric simple exclusion process for periodic bounded recognition. So you take a bunch of fermions, you put them on a ring of L size, you let the system evolve and you want to know the stationary measure for this object. So, just to give you a flavor of how it's done, so remember there was this DHT that generated the evolution. So there is an effective Hamiltonian that will generate the evolution on the 2-point correlation function G, meaning that to evolve G, I apply this the exponential of minus E small DHT. The explicit expression is given by this object, so these are still the same noise, and here they are basically permutation matrices, so they are non-zero only at site J and J plus one, at row J and column J plus one, and the other way around here. And those guys form a simple road system for SUL, meaning that tells you that the qualitative, if I speak a bit qualitatively, that since they form a simple root system, by acting with them, you can generate the whole group. And being in a stationary measure means that all your objects are invariant by action of the group. So that's what I've written here, the stationary measure invariant by the action of element of SUL. And then a compact way of formulating the answer is like this. So you write down the generating function, z of a. So this is just a definition of the generating function. It's the so this infinity is for the stationary measure. It's the average of exponential of stress of ad. So just to be clear that this is a generating function. With this object, so A is my test function. With this object, if I take partial derivative with respect to elements of A, I can generate all the possible momentum of G's. Okay, so this object is equivalent as knowing the stationary probability distribution. And since we made the remark that the stationary measure must be invariant by the action of element of SUL, this means that this Z of A has the following expression. So it's the integral over all the elements of the group of this quantity where I, so G0 is my initial condition, where I acted with all the possible unitaries, okay, on G's, and then I average over this action with the natural measure, the uniform measure on the unitary group, which is the R measure. Okay, so it turns out that this integral is known. It was computed by Harish Chandra, Tixon, and Zuber. So I didn't put the results, but you can you have an explicit expression for this thing in terms you can decompose it in a sum of the characters of the different representation of SUL. And this gives you the answer to the problem, okay? Because by taking this explicit expression, you are able to compute everything you want in your problem. So that's pretty nice. So for the closed case, we have a compact solution. So one interesting fact that I just want to point out is that you can show that in the thermodynamic limit there is a large deviation principle, meaning that this object, the generating function, when I take this scaling, okay, and take L to infinity, it's of this form, and this is this large deviation function. And equivalently, so as Kieran said, you can take the Jean transform of this guy. And you can make an equivalent statement on the probability distribution, okay? Meaning that in the stationary measure, the probability of G to be equal to a target matrix G is of this form. Okay, so this is nice because to our knowledge, there was no such large deviation principle for a quantum system before that. So that's nice to see that there is a way to formulate equivalent things for quantum models. Okay, now I want to talk a bit about the open case. So you can study out of equilibrium situation by connecting your fermionic chain to injecting and extracting terms on the left and the right, and those are the way you describe them is the same that is with Lindblad as in Marco and Lennart's talk. The good thing is that this does not break the fact that the state is still Gaussian because the Lindbladians are quadratic in a creation and annihilation operator. So you can still restrict to this two-point function. And we are going to play the same game, okay? We are going to try to get the steady state distribution of this guy. So in for the mean, just to give you a bit of physical ground. So in mean, this thing is just the what do you expect is that this thing is going to be a linear profile, right? Because it's just on the diagonal, it's just the density at site I, okay, the elements. And since you have a diffusive system and that you're putting out of equilibrium, the answer is that there is going to be a linear profile between your density on the left and your density on the right. And again, because of the coherence phenomena, the off-diagonal contribution are zero. And now you can ask about the next order momenta or the fluctuation of this guy. So for that, to discuss that, I need to introduce some diagrammatic. So it's quite simple. You have your two-point function that is your fundamental object you want to know about, and you're going to represent it this way. So it's by an arrow going from site I to j. Okay. So for instance, the local density GII is just a bubble, and you can have objects like that. I will just state some facts without proving them. So in the steady state, it happens that only the closed diagrams have a non-zero value. So for instance, okay, this guy is not closed, it's going to be zero in the stationary state. And this guy, it was zero, as you remember, but this guy was not zero, okay, because it's closed. And another nice thing is that in the large system size limit, the dominant contributions are given by loops, and loops are endpoint diagrams. There are loops. It's explicit. And they scale L to the power minus N minus 1, where N is the number of points. So we will focus on this kind of object. And I just want to show you what are the what the equations look like, because so for the open case, we were able to obtain a solution, but it was built in a rather tedious recursive way, and we have no clear structure of the underlying structure. So here, the question is open, and if you have any idea, it would be very nice. And I just want to show you how are the basic equations that we use to build these loops. So, as I said, in continuous limit, what matters are those cyclic loops, and you can index them with cyclic permutation, okay? Because you can always permutation tells you that this point goes to this point, this point goes to this point, okay? So there is a nice way of enumerating all those objects by elements of the cyclic permutation group of p elements. Sorry, I changed notation. Yeah, it's the number of points is p. I note them like that. So this is for the average. And it works like that. Okay. No, so now you have your points on this line, and when all the points are far apart, okay. So they are labeled by this vector x. The equation they fulfill is zero Laplacian condition. Okay, so this comes from the diffusion. So if everything is far apart, it's just that the Laplacian of this thing is zero. Okay, so now you have a Cauchy problem to solve, because you know that the equation for points far apart are these Laplacian things, and you know what you need to know are the boundary conditions. So what are the boundary conditions? So you have so remember we are not on a periodic lattice anymore. It's you have a finite size L, and I normalize the space by L, so it goes from 0 to 1, and it occurs that for p greater or equal to 2, this thing cancels as the boundary. Okay, so this gives you the condition for x1 equals 0 and xp equal 1. And now the additional boundary condition that you need is whenever there are two points that come close together. So x1 comes close to x2 or x2 comes close to x3, etc. And these are given by those equations. Now those are the really weird and hard ones. So you have the exchange relation. So this one is pretty easy. So tau j is my notation for the elements of the group of permutation that permutes points j and j plus 1. Okay, and this means that if you evaluate this thing at xj equals xj plus 1, you have to obtain the same result for the diagram where you permuted these two points, and then you can make them close together. So this is like this. Okay, this sounds not too crazy. And the other one is a condition that relates the derivative of sigma and tau j sigma to this object. So sigma minus and sigma plus, and I'll explain what they are. So sigma minus and sigma plus are objects obtained from a given loop by breaking it into two smaller loops. Okay, so you have a big loop made of p points, and then you want to know the boundary condition for j and j plus 1. And what you will do is that you have a systematic way of building smaller loops that are taken by breaking at point j and j plus 1. Okay, And the value of the derivative of the big loop is related to the value of the derivative of the small loop. So, okay, that's life. That's what it is. And this set of equations, okay, gives you a systematic recursive way of building your answer. But as I say, it's a recursive procedure, and we don't know what is the structure behind those equations yet. So just so for your information, so there is also a large deviation principle in this case. So you can write the generating function in this way, in the thermodynamic limit. And this large deviation function, it can be expressed solely as these loops. So this gives you recursively the answer in the thermodynamic limit. One last thing I want to comment really quickly is that in another set of work, we ask ourselves the question, the following question. So classically, we know that ASEP in the weakly asymmetric limit can be mapped to KPZ. We just wonder if the same for the quantum case. So, okay, it's true. So this is the result. Okay, so it's not a trivial statement, but I just wanted to put it for information. Explicitly, how it manifests is that you can define a quantum height field. Okay, so it's really a quantum observable, and it's defined as the integrated number of particles from minus infinity to some index k. And this thing, if you write the equation in the discrete, it looks like that. So it's you have a discrete Laplacian term here and a gradient square, like in the KPZ equation. And you have a noise term, which is a quantum noise, because it depends on the quantum coherences. And alpha is your anisotropy parameter, so it's your difference between a jump between left and right. And if you do the 1-2-3 scaling, so you rescale the height, the time, and the space, and while taking the weakly asymmetric limit, so the limit where the thing becomes symmetric, you get in the continuous a KPZ type equation. So I just wanted to mention that. So with that, I come to my conclusion. So what I've presented to you is a generalization of classical exclusion processes to the quantum realm. So the structure is not fully deciphered yet for the open case, but it seems that there is a structure. Something also I wanted to mention is that the approach that I used to guess the stationary distribution for the closed case can be generalized to other type of setups. It can be actually made very general, and it can be an approach for quantum thermodynamics. So how does this thing work is that what I said for the closed case is that you generate the full group with the simple roots, okay? So you generate all unitaries and you average over them, okay, to get the stationary measure. And this is reminiscent a bit of like the ergodic hypothesis for classical system, right? Okay, because how do you do thermodynamics? In classical physics, you say that there is a sheet where you fix your energy E, and then you say that the ergodic hypothesis says that you're going to explore all the states with this fixed energy, and then they all have the same weight, and this is your macrocanonical ensemble. So you can do the same for the quantum case by starting from this assumption that you generate all unitaries with that commutes with some Hamiltonian. You take the R measure on this ensemble you get for your quantum microcanonical ensemble. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention.
Would you have in mind any experimental
realization
of such model?
No. I guess you will have to. Actually, it's more complicated than that. So we didn't find this model the way I told you by just looking at classical things and generalizing to quantum. Actually, these things comes from a problem from condensed matter, where you take a spin chain real spin chain, XX or XXZ, and then you have local dephasing, okay? And then in the limit of like a strong dephasing and a long time, the effective description is the quantum set. So that's how we came across it. So I guess the question will then be transported to that. So how do you make XX spin chain with dephasing?
Almost an experimental realization already formulated. That's fine.
Okay.